Jesus Christus natus est hodie. Jesus Christ is born today. Brothers and sisters, as we come in this evening, we remember that God has become flesh, that he lives not only here, but he lives in each and every one of us. Praise the Lord. As we come in this evening, we call to mind our sins, and we ask the Lord for his great pardon and his strength. Lord Jesus, your mighty God and Prince of Peace, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are Son of God and Son of Mary, Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the Word made flesh and splendor of the Father, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. May he forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. For Zion's sake, I will not be silent. For Jerusalem's sake, I will not be quiet. Until her vindication shines forth like the dawn and her victory like a burning torch. Nations shall behold your vindication and all the kings your glory. You shall be called by a new name pronounced by the mouth of the Lord. You shall be a glorious crown in the hand of the Lord, a royal diadem held by your God. No more shall people call you forsaken or your land desolate, but you shall be called my delight and your land espoused. For the Lord delights in you and makes your land his spouse. As a young man marries a virgin, your builder shall marry you. And as a bridegroom rejoices in his bride, so shall your God rejoice in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When Paul reached Antioch in Pisidia and entered the synagogue, he stood up, motioned with his hand, and said, "Fellow Israelites, and you others who are God-fearing, listen. The God of this people, Israel, chose our ancestors and exalted the people during their sojourn in the land of Egypt. With uplifted arm, he led them out of it. Then he removed Saul and raised up David as king. Of him he testified, 'I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will carry out my every wish.' From this man's descendants, God, according to his promise, has brought to Israel a Savior, Jesus. John heralded his coming by proclaiming a baptism of repentance to all the people of Israel. And as John was completing his course, he would say, 'What do you suppose that I am? I am not he. Behold, one is coming after me. I am not worthy to unfasten the sandals of his feet.'" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. She was found with child through the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her husband, since he was a righteous man, yet unwilling to expose her to shame, decided to divorce her quietly. Such was his intention when, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary, your wife, into your home. For it is through the Holy Spirit that this child has been conceived in her. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke, he did as the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and he took his wife into his home. He had no relations with her until she bore a son, and he named him Jesus. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. Good evening. Warm welcome to our guests, our Catholic and non-Catholic brothers and sisters, and everything in between. Welcome. Those of you in back, I am standing up, so you know. They usually ask me to stand on phone books, so sometimes I have to get a running start to the altar, but hope you can see me. I'll never forget January 13th, 2013. I was having dinner with a couple that I'm friends with in this restaurant in D.C., in Washington, D.C. And they leaned over
and they said, "Father, have you heard about Lance? Have you heard about Lance?" And I said, "Who's Lance?" They said, "Lance Armstrong. Have you heard what he said today?" I said, "No, I don't have a TV. I haven't heard." They said he came out and he admitted that he had lied. And he admitted the whole thing, just threw it all out. January 13, 2013, and I was like, "Wow, are you kidding me?" And as I began to read about this, and you remember this, right? After years of denying that he was doping, years of attacking people that tried to call him to the mat, years of what he said, bullying people that tried to bring him to truth, he finally came out and said, "I did it. I did it." And he then later said, "I got sick of living a fairy tale. I got sick of living a fairy tale." And as he was talking to Oprah Winfrey, he said something, maybe you remember this. She said, "Well, why are you telling us now? After you've been stripped of 7 Tour de France titles, why are you coming out now?" You know what he said? He said, "You know, I want something more. I want something more. I got sick of living the lie." You know what, folks? Let's be honest. Lance Armstrong is not a saint. And if you're like me, you're not one either. But without realizing it, he put his finger on 2 very important things. Number one, most of us, we all know what it's like to lie to cover a lie, right? We've all been there. Come on. And if you're saying not, you're lying to cover your lie, right? So we've all been there, okay? And then he also said, "I want something more out of life." You ever feel that way? You know, I just want something more. There's got to be something more out of life. We've all been there. Those of you that have brought new life into this world, you know the moment that you're holding this baby in your lap, And you realize, wow, man, there's got to be something more, because this child didn't come from me. It's bigger than me. This child is bigger than me. And those of you that have been to a funeral and you've buried your children, and you've buried those children that you've brought into this world, and you've buried your parents and your sisters, and you hope for something more. It's writ into your heart. It's writ into your heart. It's tattooed in your heart and mind. Thank you, Jesus. There's got to be something more. I mean, I don't know about you, but I love living, but if this is all there is, that's kind of depressing. There's got to be something more. Folks, it goes like this. If you're looking for something more, the way you find something more is to go to someone more. Let me just say that again. Because maybe we've had a little eggnog and, you know, feeling kind of tipsy, right? If you're looking for something more, you got to go to someone more first, not second. If you go to someone more, naming Jesus Christ, you're going to find something more second. What's something more? Happiness. Meaning. Amen? That's what we're all about. Buddhist, Muslim, Hindu, Catholic, Protestant, Jew, Gentile, atheist, we all want that. Pick your flavor. We all want happiness. That's it. You know, I'll never forget, about 8 years ago, I was working in a parish here in Memphis. And one of our parishioners brought me one of my favorite things, chocolate truffles. Now, I have to tell you, I really, really love fruitcake, but I can't tell anybody. So I guess the cat's out of the bag. But they brought me chocolate truffles, really good ones. And so I confess, during the 4 o'clock Mass, I kept thinking during Mass, I thought, after Mass, I'm going to go get my chocolate truffles. I'm going to get a glass of wine. I'm going to sit down and watch Elf. Awesome. So I'm waiting. I'm kind of, you know. And I finally get back to the rectory after Mass. I get my wine. I turn on Elf. And I go to get my truffles. They're gone. And now I'm starting to sweat. I'm like, where are the truffles, man? Where are the truffles? I'm looking around. There's one other priest there. But I thought, he's a priest. There's no way he's going to take me. Right? So I'm looking around, looking around. I look in the trash. There's the packages. So right then, the priest walks out of his room. You could see steam coming out of my ears. And I said, Father, did you eat my truffles? And he looks right out and he's like, Father, no. I would never do that. And I looked at him, I said, you know, Father, it's a sin to lie to a priest. So I said, I'm going to ask you one more time, very, very calmly. Did you eat my truffles, yes or no? And he looks at me, he's like, no way, no way. And I said, you got a little chocolate right here in your mouth. So he finally fessed up. He said, Father, I'm so sorry. And he said, look, I'll make it up to you. He said, Father Ben, have you ever had a chocolate martini? And I said, no, I haven't. He said, have a seat. So I got half an hour before the next mass. Go ahead. So he made me a chocolate martini, and then he made me another one. And let me tell you, after two chocolate martinis, I didn't think about the truffles anymore. I mean, think about them. But I've known this priest for years, and as I was talking to him, I sat down with him, and I asked him a question I never asked him before. I said, Father, why did you become a priest? He's 20 years older than me. I said, why did you want to become a priest? You know what he said? Without even hesitating, he said, you know, Father Ben, I wanted to give my life to something more than me. I wanted to give my life to something more than me. Brothers and sisters, long after you and I are gone, that something more is going to live on in your children and your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren, and they're going to be looking for it just like you and I. And if you think I'm crazy, if you think I'm making this up, think about this. Ladies, I want to talk to the women here for a second. All the women. Have you ever dated a loser? Okay, so if you're sitting next to your boyfriend, you don't have to raise your hand. But have you ever dated a loser? Think about this. All the time, I hear women tell me, Father, you know, are these guys, they're just interested in one thing. They don't want to commit. They don't want to grow up. They're all Peter Pan. They're afraid of being men, real men. And if you talk to some of these women, you know what they say? I want something more. You ever work a dead-end job? You ever work a job where you think, I want to have a fulfilling occupation? Is that too much to ask? And I want to be contributing to something more than just me. Am I just here to pay some bills and that's it? And then I fill a pine box in Calvary Cemetery? There's got to be something more. You know, as a priest, sometimes I'm talking to people that have had a series of one-night stands. And they sometimes will come to me and I'll say, and it's one of the things that they will often say after they've had a series of one-night stands is, Father, after I wake up the next day, there's self-regret, there's shame, and there's this like loathing for me and this other person. And I say, well, why do you do it then? I don't know, Father. I just want something more. I just want something more. There's got to be something more. What about money? You know, we all have bills to pay. No matter what business you're in, we need to make a profit to survive. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with money. But if our possessions possess us, then we've got a problem. Because if your possessions possess you, it's never going to be enough. You know, a lot of wealthy people, they never get to the point and they say, whew, I'm here now. That's enough wealth for me. No. No, it's never enough because they want more, okay? There's nothing wrong with money as long as it doesn't control us, folks. There's got to be something more. And the way to find something more is to go to someone more. Because we are from that someone more, and we're going to go back to that someone more. That's the Christian message. Is that someone more comes among us this evening, folks, not in grandeur, not in a stretch Hummer. He comes among us in total poverty. It's almost ludicrous if you think about it. Really? That's where we come from. Anybody ever been to Austin, Texas? Anybody been to Austin? Anybody know what the motto of Austin, Texas is? Keep Austin weird. Love it. Keep Austin weird. And let me tell you, folks, if you and I live our Christian faith, we are going to be just like people from Austin. They're going to think we're weird. You ever seen that bumper sticker that says, "Normal people scare me"? I love that. Love that. Because Christianity is not normal. And if you live your Christianity, you will be scary for other people. They're going to be like, wait, whoa. Don't take that Christianity thing way too seriously now. Getting a little Jesus freak on me now. And those are the people in your family. Those are the Catholics. No, you're walking upstream, you and me. Because there's some awesome stuff in our culture, folks, but there's some pain and some wounds and some dysfunction going on in this world we live in. And that's where the hope of Jesus Christ is injected into it. That's where you and I come along. But inasmuch as they will look at us like we're from Austin, a little weird, they will admire you and they will follow you as a leader as well. Brothers and sisters, maybe tonight, as you come here, if you're like me, you're thinking to yourself, I want meaning in life, but I just don't know where to look. I want answers in life, but I just don't know where to look. I want more in life, but I'm not really sure where to look. And if you're looking for meaning and answers and more, man, you have come to the right place. Because Jesus Christ is born today. And we come back to that someone, not that something. But as you and I come to that little bitty someone, you will find the something. Peace.
I believe in one God.
Community. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
for those who are contemplating a call to the priesthood or consecrated life, that they embrace the call with joy. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the peace of God to gladden the citizens of all nations on earth, and that all may embrace and respect life from conception to natural death, and respect the sanctity of Christian marriage. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the safety of all who are traveling this Christmas season, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may bring an end to violence and hatred between racial and ethnic groups by helping us to respect our differences and granting us the gift of His peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Jesus, consolation of all hearts, be God's healing and strength for those suffering in body, mind, or spirit. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Jesus, King of blessedness, be God's everlasting happiness for those who have died and those who will die today, and that God will bring comfort to those who mourn deceased family members and friends during this Christmas season. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Brothers and sisters, at this point in the liturgy, we now have the blessing of our nativity scene. God of every nation and people, from the very beginning of creation, you have made manifest your love. When our need for a Savior was great, you sent your Son to be born of the Virgin Mary. To our lives, He brings joy and peace, justice, mercy, and love. Lord, bless all who look upon this manger. May it remind us of the humble birth of Jesus, and raise up our thoughts to Him, who is God with us and Savior of all, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Thank you.
Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept sacrifice for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the cause of the church.
As we look forward, O Lord, to the coming festivities, may we serve you all the more eagerly for knowing that in them you make manifest the beginning of our redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father most holy. Through your own beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your Word, through whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Savior and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin, fulfilling your will and gaining you a holy people, he stretched out his hands as he endured his passion, so as to break the bonds of death and manifest the resurrection. And so, with angels and all the saints, we declare your glory as with one voice we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints, who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that we may draw new vigor from celebrating the nativity of your only begotten Son, by whose heavenly mystery we receive both food and drink, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, please join me in thanking our contemporary choir for the music. Thank you so much. Check it out. Read it sometime this year, okay? So you have a free copy of this. All the children here, as you leave tonight, our youth group has been doing fundraising for months to get toys for our youth group, okay, for our children here. Every child here tonight will get something, okay? It may not be a Cadillac, but it will be something, okay? So right out this door, okay, youth group is ready. We've got all ages, okay? Finally, brothers and sisters, please have an awesome Christmas and know that you are well-loved. Please, if you remember nothing, don't drink too many chocolate martinis. All right? I know from experience. We're going to have a special blessing now over all of our families. You know, all of our families, we have beautiful things, and maybe if you're like me, you got a few wounds too. Maybe you need a little forgiveness. Maybe people need to forgive you. Well, this prayer is for you. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. We bless your name, O Lord, for sending your own incarnate Son to become part of a family, so that as he lived its life, he would experience its worries and its joys. Shower your blessings on the families gathered here in your name. Enable those who are joined by one love to support one another by their fervor of spirit and devotion to prayer. Make them responsive to the needs of others and witnesses to the faith in all that they say and do. We ask you, Lord, to protect and watch over these families, so that in the strength of your grace, each family member may enjoy prosperity, possess the priceless gift of peace, and as the church alive in their home, bear witness in this world to your glory. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless each of you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.